much for having me here. My name is Nina Tandon, and I'm lucky enough to be co-founder and CEO of a company called EpiBone. I would like to mention that we are a C Corp. So we are a for-profit venture. I like to tell people we're not afraid to make money. You'll see when you see what our mission is. We actually have a couple people here in the audience related to the company. Raise your hands. Hey. So I just wanted to tell you a little bit about what we do. Okay. Next slide. Do I have a clicker? Does this work? Ah, yeah. All right. So meet Noah. When he was 10 years old, he fell out of a tree and broke his ankle. And doctors were able to put it back together again, but he actually, until only about 2 years ago, had one leg longer than the other, okay? You know, wasn't able to do anything close to surfing, you know, let alone, you know, he could walk, he could do fine, but decided to take the plunge and get a surgery to put his ankle back together. Actually had it done just down the street at the hospital for special surgery. And the way doctors were able to put it back together was by cutting a piece of his hip, the bone, you know, that little pointy bone that sticks out, and cutting it out and using it to reconstruct his ankle. Okay, and as you can see, he can surf, he can do all kinds of things, but you know, as he'll tell you, he's very opinionated. This is not how people should be put back together, okay? There are millions of procedures worldwide requiring human bone, okay? After blood, it's the second most transplanted tissue. And quite simply, the only way to get human bone is to cut it out of a human. Right? And I'm a stem cell engineer, right? So this just doesn't make any sense to me at all, you know? We have cells in our bodies that put our that grew ourselves in the first place, right? Why can't we collaborate with those cells in the laboratory to grow the new tissues that we need to regenerate our bodies? Okay? And I love to call this you know, when a lot of us think about history, right? I like to think about the history of how we view the body. Okay? Where did we start? Does anyone know this image, Leonardo's Vitruvian man, right? I love this image. It's, to me, it's a celebration of the beautiful form of the human body, the symmetry and proportionality of it. And I think that, you know, implicit to this idea is that the body is a sacred thing, that if something's broken, kind of leave it alone and hope for the best. And somewhere around the turn of the last century, this idea began to change. We started developing things like cars, interchangeable parts on the assembly line. And we started to view our own bodies the same way, as a summation of parts. So if you needed a new heart, might get one from a donor, or we might engineer one in the lab, an artificial heart. But this idea was still the same. We are a summation of parts. But where we are now, what I think is so exciting as an engineer and as a human, is that this idea is starting to change. We're starting to view ourselves as an ecosystem of cells. Not just human. We've realized we're actually outnumbered 10 to 1 by bacteria, which is really cool. but we're an ecosystem of cells. And so why can't we collaborate with those cells to help us extend our healthy lives? I like to think of this as thinking of ourselves as living building blocks. Does anyone know what this picture is on the left here? Any science nerds? Yeah, it's a Drosophila embryo, okay? So that's a fruit fly embryo. Isn't that beautiful? In a future life, I'd love to make a coffee table book of images from biology. Okay, so women who code, right? We work with DNA. Okay, so a little bit of, oh gosh, I'm so embarrassed. so I come from, you know, we all have a picture like this, right? You're 8 years old, you get your first chemistry set, right? Big smile. All right, so I'm from a bit of a geeky family, I look at this picture from around that same time. We're putting together an arch, which you could argue is one of, you know, human's greatest technologies ever, right? We're putting it together at a science museum. We're smiling, right? So I look at this picture and I see a lot of things. You know, I see all of that. I see what we're doing now, actually. So my older sister Sheila on the left, she is she does photovoltaics research at GE. So that's solar panels. Okay. My younger sister Mira is a biomedical engineer working here at Con Ed in their Black Ops division, who's helping to reduce energy usage here in the city. She likes to diagnose buildings for excess energy usage, thinking of the body as the buildings as living bodies. That's me. And my younger brother Neil actually did his PhD as well, same as me, at Columbia University, and he's studying climate change for the Canadian government. So I look at that and I think, oh my God, we were also into science even back then, right? But what I really think when I look at this picture is I trace what became a very real professional preoccupation for me personally. Because my two sisters, Sheila and Mira, are both red-green colorblind, and my brother Neil has a genetic mutation on his rhodopsin gene, leading to a disease called retinitis pigmentosa. So what this meant was that we all saw the world very differently in a very real way. I mean, everyone, in a way, we have this. We have this sense of how do people see the world? And this is a preoccupation for many, right? But in my case, it was very visceral because I'd be like, hey, Sheila, those shoes don't match that dress. That is lipstick, not eyeshadow. Don't run that red light. things like that. And in my brother's case, being that he's legally blind, you know, where could he live, right? For me, biology was miraculous. It built our bodies. It mediated our experience of this thing called a life. And yet it was fallible. In other words, biology was like any other technology, right? So I followed this professional preoccupation through electrical engineering, actually. This is a digital theremin. If any music nerds are out there, that's an instrument you play, not by touching it. You're nodding, yes. and it your body interferes with an oscillating circuit, essentially, to make music. Through computer vision, landed in a field called tissue engineering here at Columbia, actually. And the motivation for our field is that we can extend our healthy lives by generating parts in the lab that can serve as surrogate replacement parts as we need them. So this is the fountain of youth, inspiration for our field. Okay, so I'm going to show you a little bit of science. The way that we do this is we try, essentially, to mimic the human body in the lab. Okay, so what do we do? What do we have at our disposal? We have scaffolds, that's biomaterials that tell cells for many reasons we don't understand how to act. We put them in advanced cell culture systems that we call bioreactors. It's sort of like a fancy fish tank, right? If you need freshwater fish, need freshwater. Saltwater fish need saltwater. What does a bone cell need, right? What does a heart cell need? So we engineer these systems. That's what we do actually on 127th Street. Come visit us at the Harlem Biospace. We're growing bones, okay? For my PhD, I actually grew heart tissue. So this is a beating piece of heart tissue about the size of a mini marshmallow. And it's beating in time with an electronic circuit that I'd built. Okay, right? So when I got a chance to speak at Girls Who Code, I said, look what we can do, right? Okay, we can build circuits that speak to cells. So what do? We engineer personalized living bone grafts with a perfect shape. It's like a perfect puzzle piece for your body. And it's made of your own cells. Okay, I mentioned to you that after blood, the number two most transplanted tissue is bone. Millions of procedures worldwide costing billions of dollars. And when you think about pediatric patients, there's just not enough bone to go around. As the population ages and the world globalizes, this problem is only going to continue to grow. The way that we do it, we take two things from the patient. We take a three-dimensional x-ray, also called a CT scan, and we use digital fabrication techniques to map that three-dimensional data to the exact size of the puzzle piece that you need. We take stem cell sample from the patient. We take adipose tissue, that's a polite way of saying fat tissue, and we extract the stem cells out of that, infuse them together, and after 3 weeks, we have a living graft that's ready for implantation. Here's a short video explaining the process. Cells, machining the scaffold, growing up the cells, bioreactor, and after 3 weeks, voila. The unique benefits of this kind of technology is that there's a perfect fit, it's made from your own cells, no risk for rejection, and because it's alive, it can continue and grow with you. So no more multiple surgeries. Okay, we're undergoing preclinical validation. We've implanted 30 pigs to date with our bones, and we see that blood vessels grow into them. So it's a really beautiful technology. Okay, now I told you we're a for-profit company. I'm honored to be here, but you might be asking yourself, why is she here, right? And one thing I want to say is that there are so many applications for a technology like this, and it is such a long road for companies like us to be able to go from the lab to the marketplace, and who wants to pay for it? And there is so much happening in the news right now about how much drugs cost, and at the same time, it is so prohibitively cost expensive for nerds like us who can get paid 10 times more than what we are getting paid to do, to follow this marathon of daily sprints to get technologies like this to patients who need them. Okay, and so for us as activists, what we do is we say, okay, let's map this out. Let's see what we can do. Let's pick an application that has the highest need, and let's go for that. And if it's a small patient population, there are incentives from the government to help companies like that, help small patient populations. In this case, it's called orphan designation. Okay, and that's one way that we can be activists. Another way we can be activists is by choosing very carefully who the investors are that we work with. And in our case, we are so proud to say that we have a person who teaches art in prison as one of our investors. We have people who've invested their not-in-profit money in the company. And we have professors at the social enterprise program invested in the company. We also have people who are not afraid to make money invest too. We are not afraid to make money. We are happy to be a for-profit company with a social mission. All right, that's all I'm going to say about that. All right, but okay, it's going to cost so much money to do this, right? And we are a team. It's so much money. Who wants to pay that, right? And I had to be very, very careful with selecting our investors to say, are you interested in a company like WhatsApp? We are not going to have a $16 billion valuation tomorrow, okay? We are sprinting every day, and it's probably going to be a decade. Are you ready for that? All right. And one thing we've also done is, you know, many people, when they price drugs, they say, let's try and price it based on what the market will sustain. If there's a small patient population, there are drugs that cost over $1 million per year per patient because there are only 150 patients who need that drug, right? What we've decided is we say, let's price our product a little bit higher than the competitive product and, you know, hope that we can sell that, because we don't want to just charge as much as we possibly can. We want to be able to really allow people to realize the benefit over time of having a better performing technology. Okay, so as I mentioned, so we've raised almost $6 million to date from a mix of grants, foundations, and yes, private investors. We're based here in Harlem. We have volunteers from the neighborhood working in the lab, and it's a really fun place to work. The director of the space is here. You want to say hi, Matt? Yeah. and we also just really believe in having fun as we go along. I'm really honored to be here. I'm excited to continue the conversation. I'll be sticking around after. So thank you very much.